Hey, I'm Tina Hax, and this is Monster World 4 for the Sega Mega Drive. So, this game came out in April of 1994 for the Japanese Sega Mega Drive, and it wouldn't be until 2012 that it would be translated to anything else for a in North America or Europe. So due to that, even though it's the last entry in a fairly popular series, this is the last game in the Wonder Boy series, this ended up becoming something of a hidden gem overall. So we play the part of Asha, who wants to become a knight. The game starts out with our father giving us a talk saying, well, because that's our dream, we should set out to find this place called Mute Tower, and we should vanquish the evil monster that lives there to prove our worth. So that's what we're going to be doing. So I've had good luck here so far. So this is a double tap to run game. Anytime that you aren't running, jumping, swinging your sword, anything like that, you end up dropping to walking speed. So because of that, a tasser by the name of Akvak, who worked on a task that was ultimately abandoned in 2008, published a finding published several findings, one of which we'll get to a little bit later, but the important one here is that there's a frame-perfect trick. If you swing your sword on the exact same frame that you would otherwise have fallen to walking speed, you'll maintain your running speed through the entirety of your sword swing. So in the RTA, we've routed in the sword boosts, which we call them. The ones that stand to gain us the most time while having the least harsh punishment if we miss them. The good news is that even though it's a frame-perfect trick, we've got a bunch of places to attempt it, since we're going to be attempting it only where we're... That's quite tight. We'll only be attempting it at points where the punishment for missing it is minimal. And that means that overall we only need to land three or four for us to end up with a net gain. So, we've arrived at Mute Tower, and we are going to storm this tower and find the evil monster that lives at the very top of it and slay them. Might have been better for us to just go into the very top of the tower when it was underground, but we're going to work with what the game gives us. So when we can get away with it, not killing enemies is almost always faster in this game. That is the Sage of Save, and we are going to steadfastly ignore his existence. Both because saving is slow and this is a speedrun, but more specifically in this route, this is the Any% with Debug Merchant route. There's an Easter egg where if we don't talk to the Sage of Save up until we get to the first town, and we don't ever use vending machines, you'll see screwed about that sell hearts. We can access what's called the Magic Merchant. The Magic Merchant sells the in-game gear and gives us the money that we need to be able to purchase it. Save time just in boss fights, because as I mentioned, we're going to be avoiding killing as much as we can. But it also opens up a really interesting sequence break that we'll be talking about a little bit later. So speaking of sequence breaks, here's the first one in this game. So we're supposed to kill that wolf, which removes the wall immediately to my right here. And after doing that, we're supposed to kill the wolf in the next room over to the left and then go the long way around to get that key. But that's slow, and bouncing off the head of your enemies, Zelda 2 style, is something that they apparently planned for in this game. So here's another smaller sequence break. Let's see if we can land it. Not too hard. It only saves about 3 seconds while you're waiting for those spikes to retract. Alright, so we're coming up on the first boss fight. This one's not too hard, and hopefully we'll get the stun lock on this boss. A little bit too far to the right here, but we'll see. So you can see the boss is able to move a couple pixels at a time. If the boss moved just a little bit more, we would have been bounced out. But we got the stun lock, and all is good. So we've defeated the creature, and now we have a genie. Our genie hates his job, and he's not going to be willing to grant us any wishes other than the wish of going to see the queen. Time to go talk to the queen. I'm gonna talk to the guards and say, hey, we're here to become a knight. They're gonna be very surprised because apparently it's not a tremendously popular position. And then we're going to completely ignore the palace and go snoop around the queen's backyard. And we're gonna talk to this person who is completely hidden in the bushes. And this is the Magic Merchant. Every time that we talk to the Magic Merchant, we get a delightful 9,990 gold as a gift. And on top of that, we're able to purchase the 3 in-game items. Except for that armor, which is the in-game armor, the legendary armor. But it's a little bit special. It's going to let us arbitrarily set the level of our companion we're about to be introduced to. So this is the marathon safe route, and now is as good a time as any to talk about what that means. So for world record attempts, purchasing the shield and picking up a healing medicine, which will heal us to full health if we ever manage to run out of health, those take way too long. All in all, that's about 25 to 30 seconds lost. So there's no way that we would do that in world record attempts. However, for the sake of marathon safety, there's no good reason not to do it. That's the only difference between the marathon safe route and the normal world record route. So we're picking up the healing medicine. Picking up an egg. Now, this is an egg for a creature that, if we had been wandering around town and talking to people, we would have come to the realization that everybody has one of these little creatures called Pepilogu. And furthermore, if we were to wander around town and talk to people, we'd be told that we need to go pray at the front of the fountain that we fell in front of. Those are relatively tricky to hit, but but that particular sword boost really demonstrates just how much time these sword boosts can save. But in order to hatch this egg, we need to pray in front of Falcon with it, so we're gonna go do that. Character is going to name Peppy for short. We're gonna make our way to the first dungeon. The queen, during that long exposition block, informed us that the four spirits of the elements have been kidnapped and trapped by an evil wizard, and the purpose of any knight in this game is going to be rescuing them. The first one that we're going to rescue is the Spirit of Earth, who is stuck in the Hendera volcano, which is where we are. Already, the purpose of our helper, Epilogu, is becoming obvious. In addition to being the cutest double jump that any game has ever had, Epilogus are also just magical beasts overall, and they have a bunch of pretty fantastic qualities. They're fireproof, they're iceproof, of course they fly with their ears. But Epi is our wonderful multi-purpose companion. Love him, and we want nothing bad to happen to him. You know, except for being pelted with fireballs or thrown on top of lava geysers or thrown on top of steam geysers or frozen in a solid cube of ice. But, you know, nothing seriously bad should ever happen to Peppy. So, speaking of backpack, another one of the glitches we found is called the Infinite Jump Glitch, which I'm about to show off right now. So, of course, the game designers didn't intend for that to ever be possible. Turns out that the ability to call Peppy is tied to whether or not you were recently in a standing animation. And the upstep in this game, for whatever reason, has one frame of that standing animation in it, which so that little hesitation actually manipulated the rate at which that fireball would have fired. We would have been stuck behind it. We hesitated. I usually hesitate a little bit differently, but that worked. Yeah, so that's another one of the things that Hackback found plays in. That's a very small skip. That skips about 10 to 15 seconds of dungeon. Later on, that skip's going to allow us to skip an entire dungeon. There's a zip there. It's 3-frame perfect inputs. I've managed to pull it off exactly once RTA. Definitely not something that we would show off in a marathon, because if you go for it and you miss it, you end up softlocking and there goes your run. the really interesting things about this game is how many different ways of using your controller you end up having to adopt to run it well. So, during normal play, I tend to hold the controller normally, as one might expect, using just my thumb to press buttons. Whenever I'm having to do something with Peppy in terms of a lot of frequent double jumps, but not the infinite jump, I'll end up clawing the controller. The infinite jump glitch requires that you use, at minimum, the up button, A, B, and C. And, A is held permanently while C is pressed, and then B should be pressed exactly one frame later. And usually you'll end up using either left or right on the D-pad as well. So at that point you end up needing to use a piano grip, which having to switch quite a lot between those different grips is really something else in this game. It's an interesting challenge, certainly. So we kind of breeze through the first mid-boss there. So I mentioned that most of the time save is in boss fights. And one of the interesting things about this game is that it's a fairly easy game casually. Most people are going to be able to beat it really in a single sitting. And the bosses themselves, I found to be quite easy. Playing this game casually, they take a few hits, certainly, but you're never in any real danger. So I've ended up really coming to quite like this run, because it's not substantially safer. Certainly it's a little bit safer, but extra hearts can get me armor. It manages to showcase the interesting and difficult movement in this run more than anything else. So we're coming up on a room that myself and White Zephyr, the world record holder, have a fairly rude nickname for. This room can definitely some damage to runs, so that's about as bad as it ever gets. Occasionally you'll see a little bit worse, but come on. There you go. So that infinite jump actually skips a lot more dungeon than it looks like. The intended solution to that room is for you to start going around and having Peppy activate a bunch of different buttons and waiting on some moving platforms. Final stretch before the first boss. So each of these rooms is timed up with the assumption that you start not holding heavy, so he ended up messing up a global timer there a little bit, but not that big of a deal. Safety. Alright, so we're coming up on our first real boss of the game, and I'm going to be going for the task kill on both cycles. It's not too terribly hard, and it saves a ton of time. There we go, that's the first cycle. Stand right here. Nope, missed the second cycle. It's just a little bit off. So we can see the time loss that you get from picking up the potion and purchasing the shield. It's two extra conversations with the magic merchant. And on top of that, waiting to pick up that potion. So there's our first use of that magic in-game armor that lets us arbitrarily set Pepe's level. Going to make use of interesting programming oversight here. We're going to infinite jump up this wall, and it ends up run warping us straight to the second dungeon, which is kind of nice. It means that we don't have to run around, talk to a bunch of people, collect an item that allows us to access the dungeon. So these fish are all on a global timer. Make these rooms pretty annoying to run through, but so far everything's going well. Alright, so casually we're supposed to run all the way to the right of the of this outer temple, and we'll get to this riddle that says you should hunt for the pillar without a reflection. We're not gonna do that, we're just gonna go through to the without a reflection into the stream temple. So the nice thing about this running water is that due to the way that it works, there's basically no punishment whatsoever for attempting a sword. So, again, the way that you perform these infinite jumps is by getting on Pepe, and then after that what you do is you jump and then do an up stab within 3 frames of that jump. And that's how you guarantee that you manage to gain height at all. So this ends up being a relatively easy trick to perform in such a manner that you never gain any height. So there's a rhythm to it that you have to learn otherwise. That jellyfish is a jerk. Those tentacle monsters also are jerks. So we're coming up on Bucket Skip, which is outside of the sequence break that totally skips an entire dungeon. It's the most significant skip in this game. So we're not going to skip a bucket, interestingly, but we are going to pick up a bucket. What we're going to skip is spending 2 minutes running around the entire stream temple. You only get one shot at it, so you have to do it well the first time. So while I was working on the tasks of this game, I picked up where Akak left off. I found a setup that works well for me, RTA. White Zephyr uses a different setup that works for him. Ironically, neither of us are able to consistently get this trick that I just pulled off with the others set up. We just got Bucket Skip. We saved about a minute and a half overall. We're now going to find out that even though our wonderful friend Peppy is able to blow out some torches, it turns out that campfires are just not his thing. That's fine, because we have a bucket. I want to really delay going back into that door. If you mash up, you can end up going through that door without ever having triggered the opening of the electric gate there. And that certainly loses some time. So that's a 2-frame window to manage to kill that tentacle monster that way. A huge time loss if you don't get it. Delaying going into that last waterfall as long as possible ends up having you move at a much higher speed. So in this case, due to the fact that we have to take a bunch of intentional damage in the next dungeon, we're going to go ahead and set up for that. So here we've done another sequence break. There's a bit of a puzzle here. There's an old man who's dying of thirst, and if we save his life, he'll tell us that the second and fourth torches need to be blown out for us to access the next area. But if you've played this game, you know that you don't actually give him water to drink. He's dying of thirst when you throw water on him. And he's in the stream temple, so I'm sure he's fine. There's a lot of water around here. I'm sure he'll find his way. So these wide pools of water, when you manage to get sword boost, definitely show off the value of sword boosting. Sync at the same speed no matter what, you're going to move to the right at the same speed no matter what, you don't don't really end up suffering. So, this is called Rapskin. It's free. Here, this Sage of Save asked if we had dropped a silver, gold, or legendary bucket into the well, and as long as we're honest, he'll let us through to face the next boss. I'm gonna go for the task right here. It's extremely difficult to get. We'll see. Almost. Even if you don't get the task strat, going for it and missing it doesn't lose any time versus the casual fight, so. Alright, so coming up, we need to go, now that we've rescued earth and water, go rescue the spirit that's been kidnapped and kept in the ice pyramids. So that's the Mage's Tower, and that's gonna be really important a little bit later in the run. The developers specifically put that up as a roadblock, so that you can go through the palace's back door. You can make it as far as that tower, and the expectation was that as a player, you're never ever going to be able to get past that tower. Alright, so it's time for the ice pyramids. What would any platforming game be without ice levels, right? So in the TAS, I sword boost a ton here, but the timing for it is really awkward RTA, so I'm not going to go for a single one of those. Here, just do those up stabs to get that call for Peppy a little bit sooner. Four damage for this section, so the fact that I've only taken one so far is pretty fantastic. It's gonna be a one damage section, not too bad. Alright, so it's time to go and talk to the Sphinx, who's going to tell us that an evil wizard has invaded, and we have to solve riddles in all three of the Ice Pyramid sections. So the way to Ice Pyramid 1 is opened up. So, the shtick in this pyramid is that there's going to be riddles all over the place that we have to use to figure out what the secret password for each of the different colored doors is. Thankfully, they're not randomized, though, so we get to just breeze through all of that. Another thing important to note is, as one might expect with ice physics, you start moving extremely slowly, so any time that we're at a standstill, the first thing that I'm going to do is jump. Statues, and there are also riddles strewn about that I'm supposed to use to figure out the order of the statues. And likewise, it's also not randomized, so Once you've memorized the statue's order, everything is good to go. That's our first really large infinite jump, and we're going to have a couple more quite sizable infinite jumps in this run. That skips us having to go on a fairly circuitous route to obtain that jackal statue. General, if you're running at full speed in the ice area specifically, it's substantially faster to swing your sword rather than jump if you're able, just due to the fact that more of your momentum is preserved that way. But of course, anything with a shield, we're not going to be able to swing our sword at. We've got our first five statues, so we can solve the riddle of this pyramid. There's a bunch of different little riddles that you're supposed to use to figure out the order. I have a really dumb mod that I use, especially dumb due to the fact that it's spelled incorrectly. That is those bad oats. Turtle Hound Owl Sparrow is the first pyramid. Bad is misspelled B-A-O-D, because it's the only way that I could make it work. So here's our first mini-boss of two, actually. And we're gonna pick up that big heart, but it's not gonna cost us much time at all. Pyramid 2, and the thing to learn about here is that you've got hidden doors. In theory, you're supposed to use Peppy to help you find those hidden doors, but that's slow, and it's much quicker to just memorize where those doors are. So here, at this point, this is a false floor, and if you let yourself fall down there, you're going to lose about 3 minutes. There's a safety strap that you can use to use Peppy to kind of do a double jump over there, which if this were a proper marathon run, I would be doing. So as I mentioned, we want no harm to ever come to Peppy. Thankfully, Peppy actually enjoys, ignore the face that he's making, he enjoys being frozen in an ice cube. You see, he's fine. Yeah. this is a fun one. The first time you play this game. Surprise, there's an Anubis in here, and you don't know where the door is. So you're stuck in there, in a battle to the death. Those hidden doors. There's a little bit left to do in this period. Also have a jackhammer in this game. So bird, angel, owl, dog. That's how we spell bad. That's the only misspelled word in this mnemonic. Too bad. So, Japanese text is substantially faster in this game, but unfortunately it does mean that you have to do a quiz of 20 randomly selected questions. Slow. Too bad. That one miss obviously cost some time, but... So, we're already introduced to the gimmick for this particular pyramid. We've got this ice, and this ice is important because we can't change direction, and if we try and jump, we fall. We're actually going to use that mechanic advantage in just a little bit. Turns out that there's an enemy whose AI can be sort of cheesed a little bit, who's standing and is able to move around just fine on the ice. I suppose he's wearing cleats. There's a particular route through this pyramid that tends to be the fastest, owing to the fact that we've got the infinite jump on our side. Placement. That's fine. hear the value of the infinite jump glitch when it comes to breaking the layout of this pyramid is going to become immediately obvious. So the intended solution here is for us to go through the entire pyramid and backtrack, go up a really slow elevator and go through the top. That's slow, so we're not going to do that. Almost didn't get that one. A little bit more than 5, maybe 10 seconds worth of routing through this pyramid. So now, at minimum speed, we glitch out this enemy's AI and just hop right on past. So we've got 4 of the 5 statues. We have to go backwards in terms of the pyramid's layout just a tiny bit to get the last of the statues, and we'll be good to go for the final boss, or the final boss of this section. Final word in that phrase that we've been using is Opus. So, Owl, Angel, Turtle, Sparrow. Time to fight the Iceman. I'm not really worried about taking damage here. I assume we're gonna have a fight that we have to lose, so we wanna end up a little bit low. Last ice pyramid has gone well. We've rescued the spirit of the element of gnome. And so now we're supposed to go and try and talk to the queen. The guards are refusing us access. And we're supposed to wander around town and talk to townspeople and try and figure out what's up. And all of these Pepe Le Goose turn evil. But that's a really slow cutscene, so. Instead, we're just gonna skip all of that. So, the game never expects us to be able to go through the back door, so everything is gonna look normal, but once we get into the palace, the game's not gonna know what's going on. So, the game now decided that we're a little bit further in the game than we were otherwise. We're going to go confront the queen who we would have otherwise found out has turned evil. fight the queen. We just have to hit her 3 times and then we're done. I mentioned that the armor that we have allows us to arbitrarily set Peppy's level. And currently Peppy's level is dead, and I'm not a huge fan of that. So I'm going to run back to that mage tower. The flag has been set that the next time that we're able to talk to the queen should be after we've done the 4th dungeon, but we've already saved 3 of the 4 elemental spirits, so I feel like that's good enough. Once again, the game doesn't expect us to be able to make it back to the queen's palace. The front door is blocked by guards and there's no way for us to get in. I'm just gonna hop in and I'm gonna fight the queen. There we go. So now we've lost that fight. We're actually really bad at being a knight. And the queen's gonna mock us a little bit. It's gonna be telling us to, why don't we just call your dead creature? So this is Peppy, who it turns out is not dead. And the game really does not do well when there's multiple Peppy sprites on the screen at once. So we end up with a kind of interesting looking sprite here. But we called for Peppy and Peppy showed up, kind of broke through the castle wall a little bit. And what we were just told is that Peppy started singing and it's incredibly heartwarming. And we'd be seeing notes surrounding the queen normally, but in this case the queen is, I suppose, being menaced by some fairly nasty looking sprite garbage. But the queen is now back to her good self. The evil wizard that's otherwise been acting as her advisor has run away, and it's time for us to go and confront the final boss, the being that's behind all of this terrible. Just all the tragedy that's befallen Monster World. We've gone to the underground chasm, which it turns out is where all the minions of whoever it is that's behind all of this is. We've all gathered here and retreated to their lair. We're gonna face every last one of them. We might not kill all of them, but we're gonna face them. First time through, playing this casually, this is a fairly rewarding area because you're going through and you're fighting all of these enemies that you previously fought. For the most part, you're able to just kind of lay waste to everything that you're seeing. These two rooms, that one and the one after this one, are the reason that we call Peppy back. Overall, it does save time. All that's left is for us to face the final boss. Going to learn in just a moment is fear itself. So anybody who played Wonder Boy in Monster World for the Genesis is going to recognize this boss. And I think that anybody who's in that camp will definitely agree that this boss easily deserves the title of Fear Incarnate. Come on, there we go. Those eyeballs bouncing, the boss's main attack is that he can freeze you in place. Time is when the last text box goes away. But so that's the game. And yeah, I hope that you enjoyed that. That's Monster World 4.